Welcome everyone to the first of the open lectures for semester two. Our intention with the series is to present a wide variety of perspectives from different regions of the world to offer a wide knowledge base for our students. To create great architecture for a place, one needs to know its history, culture, landscape, climate, and aspirations of the people. And in looking at architecture, it's not only important to know roots, but also the routes that architectural ideas take. In today's lecture, Lindsay and Kerry examine their work and the influences, including modernism, history, tradition, and landscape. A range of projects from small houses to large public buildings will be discussed, demonstrating the importance of principles and their effect on continuity over varied circumstances. The projects will be presented from concept sketches, detailed design through to completion. Lindsay and Kerry have been in practice for over 35 years. They established Clare Design in 1979 on the Sunshine Coast in Queensland, Australia. And after close to 20 years of successful practice, Lindsay and Kerry were invited by the New South Wales Government architect, Chris Johnson, to undertake the inaugural role of New South Wales Government Architects Office Design Directors. In 2000, Lindsay and Kerry became the founding directors of Architecture Sydney, serving as design directors from 2000 to 2010. During this period, they produced notable projects, including the Queensland Gallery of Modern Art, and I recommend if you go to Queensland, make a point of looking it up. I saw Anish Kapoor's exhibition in there, and I think the space was really fantastic. And the University of Sunshine Coast Chancellery, the UNSW Village Housing Project, and the Wesley House in Brisbane. Since 2010, they reverted to Clare Design, and projects include Docklands Library with the City of Melbourne, the Newcastle Art Gallery redevelopment for Newcastle City Council, and selected residential projects. Larger projects are done in collaboration with selected architectural firms. Again, you know, need for collaboration, which we emphasize in studio, is paramount. In 2010, they were jointly awarded the gold medal from the Australian Institute of Architects, so we are very lucky to have them here, and you especially as students. In addition to teaching at University of Newcastle, they are also visiting professor at the Aberdeen School of Architecture, Bond University. Please all welcome Lindsay and Kerry.
Okay, thank you, and thanks very much for coming and attending, and apologies for those who have seen some of this work before, because talking about our own projects, there's only so many we can talk about. As Nina mentioned, the perspective that we're giving is from 35 years now of practice together, and that has encompassed work in a region to major city work, private practice and public works, and very small projects and some reasonably large ones. So we've been involved in a few things over the years like that. And I think that what is the message, or what is important, the message we're trying to give is for you is to have developed a position or an approach for you, or for anyone to develop architecture. One is to understand context, and by context I would include tradition, history, landscape, climate, and even your own family background and the culture that sits within. To understand that is critical to develop your own method of working. Secondly, to understand the program of the project you're working on. What is the brief, how that brief has to work, and to understand the building type. Thirdly, to interpret, to test and explore through drawing and through making, by hand or by computer in terms of drawing, but in terms of making and producing work and using materials, how to use materials, what, how they're constructed, and the means of technology of production. To also develop in your hand and computer drawings an understanding of scale. That's, I think, a very important attribute in terms of developing your own position. Fourth is environmental concerns are foremost, And whilst that is important, technically, and in the era of discussions on climate change and energy resources, etc., but most importantly, environmental concerns for social outcome. Because basically buildings don't have a social outcome or don't work unless they have a good environmental performance or a good environmental support. So architecture, as Lawrence Neal says, provides a framework for human activity or occupation. So that's quite critical for the environmental concerns to support that. I suppose finally, architecture is not fashion. In a world of perhaps too much information, you have to be selective. And when you do select, you have to observe and make appropriate decisions, make decisions appropriate to the place. As I've said many times before, in a quote of Gunnar Asplund, to follow the style of a place, not that of a time. So in terms of achieving some sort of consistency, you need to develop a set of principles or an attitude that you bring to every project. And the circumstance of that project and its context will provide diversity in terms of the solutions that you might develop. So I'm going to talk briefly about background. This is the library we've just completed in Docklands University, but my background in particular is in Queensland, and Kerry's coming through Darwin from Sydney originally. But understanding the Queensland House, Queensland public buildings, and the set of principles that were embedded in those projects in terms of ventilation of the roof, screening of edges, occupied veranda spaces, a timber tradition, and that applied to houses as well as public buildings. All the principles in this Brisbane School of Arts building in the 1880s apply to our gallery project. An inhabited edge, an edge that collects people and allows them to sort of sit comfortably within the climate of subtropical Brisbane and the rain of subtropical Brisbane, and light being balanced between an edge condition and light in the centre of the plan, to balance the strong light that one encounters in southeast Queensland. And this occupation of this edge condition and space is critical to understanding the particular context in which we started our work. Part of my personal background, my grandmother lived on Bribey Island from 1900 to 1988 in this little Nissen hut. Partly she lived in Brisbane. And she had the main bed. All the grandchildren would have other beds. And not being the eldest, I was out in the boat shed. This building was a simple timber-framed hut with plywood shutters, a tank with a shower below, and a loo under the mango tree so it wasn't too hot. Pretty basic. And Kerry's dad, being a key citron importer from the 1950s to the 1970s in Sydney, built this wonderful workshop through Christopher Kringus, who worked with Edwards Madigan and Torzello Briggs on the National Art Gallery in the High Court. And this building was built, and the workshop in action, and Kerry spent some of her time in there as part-time cleaning lady and weekend workshop observer.
As a 12-year-old.
And understood the sort of aesthetic of dealing with materials, metal, engineering, masonry, and light, and then moved to Darwin. We met in Gabriel Poole's office in the 1970s. He was producing buildings like this, the Dobie House on your left and the Schubert House on the right, the Dobie House being an interpretation of the sort of modernist tradition from the west coast of America, the 1950s, and the one on the right, the Schubert House, being an interpretation of a contemporary Queenslander with, importantly, ventilation through the whole house, through this gabled end condition, and the introduction of natural light and ventilation along the edge of the veranda and the eaves to bring light into the interior, which was a failing of the traditional Queensland houses. So we were fortunate enough to be in his office when projects like this were being produced, even though my role on this house was, for example, to design the handrails the back steps and the toilet roll holder. So it was a very sort of modest beginning in terms of what you might learn. When we started our own practice, we were fortunate enough to be given a house to do in Brisbane at Fig Tree Pocket facing north. These are the drawings that we produced in that era, 1980. They still exist, Kerry's plan and my section. And the house has recently been restored by some friends of ours in Brisbane, Stuart Vokes from Owen and Vokes, who produced these set of drawings to supplement our rather scanty drawings. They treated the house as a restoration project in introducing a new kitchen and bathrooms. And this is the house in the present day, almost 35 years later. Likewise, a series of houses we produced in the 80s explored a variety of ways of dealing with the subtropical climate. The house in Brisbane, which we were not allowed to publish, is built around three courtyards, one beside a bedroom, one beside the main bedroom, and one inserted in onto the northern courtyard beside the kitchen. And it's a house that ended up like this, and we have no real photographs, no professional photography, but this is the house sitting in the landscape and into the interiors. And it sort of brings together some of our own background and our understanding of not only the context, but our own sort of family histories and the way buildings were made. And continuing to explore houses that existed under sort of an overhanging roof condition, although this is a series of roofs connected. The client's brief to us was to produce a dwelling one step up from camping, and it is a very basic utilitarian house built with a carpenter friend of hers. Has a series of cellular masonry alcoves with service areas and a winter living room with a small fireplace, a separate kitchen, a fly-screened living room, and a couple of bedrooms. Working drawings the old way with Letraset. Remember that, Peter? the fly-screen living room. This was the furniture that she had. We designed the house around, looking northeast into the rainforest of Budrum. The winter living room, the gallery, where external materials were used internally and creating a feeling of ambiguity of where the veranda stopped and started, and the feeling that were critically living on a veranda-like space. But the same sort of principles apply from that School of Arts building, where you have a light condition on the edge and light and ventilation balanced in the middle. And that not only works well for light, but it also works well for ventilation. Following on from that, the Thrupp and Summers house, which we did in 1987-88, these photographs were taken in 2008 or 2009. The original hand-drawn sketch plans and the house as it sits today. So it's important to develop, I think, a sense of consistency in the attitude that you bring to projects, a consistent set of principles that you can go back 20 or 30 years later and not feel totally embarrassed by the decisions that you've made. We are embarrassed by some decisions we've made, but not by all of them, and not by the key ones.
We've learned from.
And our own house, when we had five young children, hence the Volkswagen van, a little site facing northeast down to the ocean on the side of Budrum. We didn't have enough money to build one of our own houses, so we were going to put a shed on a farm shed and do an interior, and one of our local builders said that he thinks he could do the shed for the same price in timber. So we sat around talking to him about how to make this building and developed a series of sort of plywood frames, which you can see in the plan here, which ordered the plan. By placing a stair and a bathroom in this location, we had a bedroom, one in for ourselves and living space, and a girl's end and a boy's end with a place to meet in the middle. It was a great deal of flexibility in terms of how the building could be made or how it could be altered in time. But it did achieve very economically a sensible building for us to live in with a young family, and which would need to be modified over time. and shots of the living space on a winter's morning. The stair and bedroom beyond. And the stair handrail was also used to as a screen to terminate the living room, but also support the treads and then move upwards to become the handrail. So trying to look at using simple elements that could do many things, which is the same as in planning, to try and get spaces that are useful in one way or in a way they're prescribed, but they may have other uses that you've not thought of. So try and simplify your lives and make spaces and elements do more things. Eliminating tiles in the bathroom and simplifying the cabinet work, the upstairs area. And how things were made. Kerry's dad bought a pipe bending machine for his farm, so we decided to use some pipe and get them bent and made up for our handrails. And we always used to curve the handrails back or bend them and put a plate on top so that when kids climb up and then they lean backwards, they fall back onto the deck rather than over it, which is a detail that we've used many times and generally works pretty well. It still has to comply, of course. And following that house, we did a little house up in the mountains north of Noosa, looking back over the coast, which was a largely prefabricated project using a similar construction method. The scale of the house is 8x10, so it feels like a small cubby house or a cupboard sitting in the landscape, which is an incredibly vast view, about 500 metres above sea level. The entry deck becomes the recreation deck. The kitchen dining is also the laundry. The bookshelf is a bracing element for the house in terms of cyclone resistance. The divan is also a guest wing, guest area. All of these things are sort of working together, and even though the spaces are quite small, the diagonal connections through the plan make the spaces feel much larger than they really are. This is the set of drawings that were the construction set. The house as it sits. Because it was remote, it was solar powered and had its own waste system and gas for refrigeration. A lot of these elements were prefabricated, as I said. The gangnail trusses were standard trusses that you cover up. The walls are prefabricated, but without a bottom plate, so there's no rotting of the timbers as you get in traditional Queensland houses. And the trusses were tied into the walls, so the wind speed was, 62 metres per second, which at the time was the highest cyclone category. And these plywood elements were then used to tie the trusses down to the ironbark bearers, which were then bolted onto the ironbark posts. It's all fairly simple and straightforward construction and simple and straightforward cabinet work. We also got involved in some medium density housing projects, such as Rainbow Shores, which was the first time we really looked at medium density housing. There was no real models upon which to draw, so we had to sort of develop our own sort of criteria for how to do these sort of townhouse type projects in a subtropical condition. And that led to us working on the Cotton Tree housing project, which was a mix of public and private housing on one of the oldest sites in Cotton Tree, unlike Rainbow Shores, which was on a former sand mining lease. So this project was originally two strips of land in parallel with a group of trees in the centre, and we re-subdivided the land to make the boundary sit on the trees, thereby saving the trees, and arranged the public housing on one side and the private housing on the other so they would be indistinguishable. In terms of look, feel, cost, etc. And that largely worked and has proved to be a successful development for both the private developer and the public housing consortium, or the public housing department. It was an interesting lesson for us because Kerry mandated that every bathroom and every space should be naturally lit and ventilated. And so we worked very hard on the planning to achieve that. We also, in terms of saving the landscape, gained a lot more shade. We used the parking areas to become like play courts where kids would play with cricket bats and whatever. So the parking areas became social spaces, as well as just and avoiding the sort of horrible underground car parking, which could have happened where you drive down to a basement, which is horrible, and come up in the lift. This has the same density as a three-storey walk-up with basement car parking, which is what is generally surrounding the site now, when it was originally small fibro beach shacks like this.
Okay. Bit of a leap forward here. This is our student housing project, and when we were students working in Gabriel Poole's office, he said to us, you know, if you can design a house, you can design anything. And, you know, we just all sort of took that at face value as students. But looking back now, I realise really what he was saying, that housing is so complex that if you can work... people think housing is easy because everyone lives in a house and knows the type. But to get it right, socially and contextually and orientation, you know, environmentally, is a you know, big sort of problem. And if you know how to work your way through those sort of things, you can bring all those principles that you learn from housing to larger projects. And basically that's what has driven our work, our understanding of the principles from the early work. Okay, so we were approached by a group that actually do student housing as they approach it from a social aspect, in that they put students together in groups of five mostly. They had done a lot of research and a lot of delivery of housing. They found that groups of five students work really well sort of politically, and they would engineer that there would be a sort of a senior student in with younger ones, etc. So we were asked to do households of five. You could have less, you could have more, depending on the, you know, what the site allowed, and each one of them had their own living, dining, kitchen. So that's the model. There's lots of different student housing models. There's sort of like the motel rooms, and but this is more sort of a communal pastoral care type arrangement. So we developed around this site that was heavily treed a whole series of thin plan buildings that created courtyards, and you can see that in this, you know, these are the thin plan buildings. You've got some facing north, then the east-west taller buildings, and these ones on the south of the site still getting northern aspect. That was a sketch that we did early in the piece. It was a design competition. And these are the eight-storey buildings, and they each come to the north boundary, which is High Street in Kensington, and we were very determined that they were clearly marked entries and welcoming, and in fact they are a way through to the campus proper, and although that you sort of need a swipe access to get into the student housing, you can sort of see through to the public spaces beyond. So connectivity to the street and to the campus were a big important part. And in this image you can see that there's sort of glazing around it, and through it you can see that you're, there is a way through. Another entry, there's about, how many of those? Five or six. Yes. Foyers, we allowed a bit of extra space because we thought that they were useful places for exchange and meeting and greeting. A lot of those sort of places are quite mean in buildings, and always try to get natural light into those spaces because so that people do want to stay and dwell. One thing we did fail at, we tried very hard to get some acoustic treatment, but because it was a design and construct, we lost that battle. So one day they'll retrofit some acoustic treatment into that. But basically this is the concept, in that with the taller buildings facing east-west. But these taller buildings were like bridges. We raised them up so that there was quite a high space and visual contact right through the whole site to these little group of heritage buildings. This is where NIDA started. and back through to this main entry. So this very clear and public access through the site was part of the main concept. And then, as I said before, we've got all these foyers facing onto the street. These foyers all have, at every level, windows so that there's connection back to the campus. You always have orientation and connection. This is what looking through, that's that big walkway through the site, to the different courtyards that had different characters, because some of them already were preserving trees that were there and some didn't have anything. They were where small buildings had been demolished, so there was a whole series of ones that some of the existing trees. And you can see that these are east and west facing, but every apartment had the dual aspect. That means that they all had through ventilation from one side to the other. And where you had student bedrooms, and the rooms were big enough for a desk, and so the idea was that you could retreat and to your room. You've got you can do your work, your uni work, in your room, and then come out and have the communal living dining kitchen. But when your door's closed, you haven't got any cross ventilation, and we thought that was a real problem because people will stay in their rooms. So we used a hollow core floor slab, which has holes right the way through. And made it so that when you've opened your window, you can open a vent here and the air is drawn through. And we had that tested environmentally and modelled before it was built, of course, and it does work. A lot of people argue that a small opening won't help with cross-ventilation, but it certainly does. And that's the vents there showing and the hollow core of the slab. And so we got this crossover through ventilation to every room. So environmental concerns are a big driver in our work. And that's the part of the building that addresses the important entry. So, we sort of put a bit of money into the materials at that end. It was a very low-cost housing project. Oh, back to
Lindsay. Yes, sometime on the Sunshine Coast, when we were struggling with a few houses, we were designing a garage conversion to a bedroom for these people. A very unpromising brief, especially when the garage was as cruddy as the one that we were faced with. And we were just starting to do the drawings, and they got a phone call from the clients who were at the time skiing in New Zealand. They said, they're flying back, their building is burnt down. They had a cable ski kiosk on the cane fields adjacent this sort of man-made lake, and a cane fire drifted across and it had a shingle roof and it burnt the whole thing down.
It was a building we knew
We had nothing, we'd never been there, we didn't even know how it worked. All of these sort of equipment was lying in the lake, all bent and twisted. And they said that it had to design and construct a new building within 16 weeks to be ready for Christmas. And we just said, well, we just can't be done. And after some sort of negotiation, discussion and a fair bit of laughter, we started. And we went to the council with one of the best builders on the coast and one of the most reliable engineers, and presented this drawing, which sort of set some sort of portal frame up, and said, can we start? And they said, yes, you can. So I wrote keep on the plan, and that was how we started. We got permission to start work on site. And while they were building the portal frame to make this main structure, we then designed the ancillary parts around, and it did get built and opened within 16 weeks with a fair bit of... We had a guy on site every day. In the middle of all that, we went to New York for 2 weeks because it was a pre-planned trip. So the whole thing was totally chaotic. You might say there's a fair bit of spontaneity involved. And that's the finished project.
Because we had to work off the stumps too.
We had to work off the stumps. They're ironbark posts, thankfully, so we cut the posts and put new columns onto the existing posts and painted them black to match the charred post and put a new plan on the old footing, so some of them were straight and some of them sort of go off at all sorts of odd angles and twists and bends. But anyway, it's all structurally sound, apparently. So it got built and opened. And this is one of our sons, who's now a builder on the Gold Coast. And these were the working elevations and sections, which turned into final drawings, which we had to present to council at the end. And it opened before Christmas, and we went there to see how it all worked. And here they are. And the funny thing was that in doing it all, in consultation with the client, they originally would have five people working in this place. And they said in the down season, when they still had had five people because they had five different areas. And we reorganised it so they could have one person. So it actually saved them a huge amount of money commercially to do this. They didn't engineer the fire, but it had a good commercial outcome for them. And because of that, the local university sort of heard or read about it, and the Vice-Chancellor wanted the recreation club for the students to be open in 18 weeks. So he rang us up and said, can you do that for us? But the difference is the university had a different set of criteria. So whilst the first project was done on the fly with scrappy drawings and a builder in hand, we had 6 weeks to design, document and produce a set of tender documents for a design which we hadn't quite realised, and it was built in 12 weeks. And so these are some of the drawings we were producing in 1996. And that's the sort of final plan. It basically was a sort of a trust project with edges that could observe sporting fields. So the building faced north, but looked east and west to sporting fields that ran north-south. And the main building was separated from the amenities, so that the amenities could be expanded, or the main building could be expanded separately. And as it turned out, it's been used for sporting events, recreation, classrooms, examination areas, for students, because the students actually like using the building, all naturally lit and ventilated, of course. And there's a subtropical storm, probably in October, Sunshine Coast. You can tell from the grass, they don't get much rain up there in August and September. And the interior set up that this structural frame was set up with cross-braced trusses and Ritec sandwich panel roofs, which cantilever, which span about 4 or 5 metres and cantilever 1.5 to 2 metres. So while that was being put up, all of the glazing was being made separately to a different package, and it was brought in with a sort of a little adjustment detail if we got something wrong, and that was then all clipped into place and the building was open. All of the wiring and ducting was up in this sort of duct here. And similar sort of set of drawings that we do. I mean, documentation, I was talking to a student earlier this morning about how to detail. It's still, detailing is still design. Detailing is the continuation of your concept into thinking through how things are going to be made. And the best way to do it is to talk to someone who's going to actually make it, so that you can get some first-hand knowledge back from their expertise. The foreman at the end of the job said it was the most enjoyable building he'd worked on in his whole career. So, all this stuff about architects being difficult to work with shouldn't really be true, should it? Okay, a slightly bigger project.
All right, moving into public projects, and as I said before, the lessons we learned in housing we still use in larger projects. This is the Queensland Gallery of Modern Art, which was an international design competition.
Which we were directors of Architectus at the time, and we worked with James Jones on the project.
That's right. Design. Yeah. our knowledge of the climate and of Brisbane helped us clarify the design of the building. This is the site in the competition that we were given, and we understood the economy that was required because it was a finite budget, unlike some gallery projects, and it also had to be part of the city, part of the history, the context. So we understood that the older buildings on the river were generally perpendicular to the river, and they generally, the old rowing clubs and things that sort of characterised the early Brisbane on the river, had the outdoor room, the veranda, onto the river, which was an important social space. So those sort of things informed even an art gallery project. A design concept drawing during the competition, and the project that was completed in 2006, showing how this large roof is creating our outdoor room. And this has been quite a successful space for the gallery because it allows people to use the area around the gallery. They don't have to commit themselves to, I'm going to an art gallery today. It's sort of more of a social space. It's a gentle introduction. Some people use it on their cycle way. This is a cycle way. You know, it's got so many different aspects to it. It's not just a singular use. Construction drawings showing how we constructed the roof, how we constructed the glazing, and I'm not sure, this might have come from a different lecture, but a canopy roof that we put outside the entry that was pulled off for cost savings, unfortunately. I think that was another very important part of our thinking, that a gallery should have edges around it that people can use and occupy, and the entrance should be covered because Queensland weather, it's either too hot or too wet or something like that, too glary. So shade and shelter are an important part of that language and character of the buildings. The northwest elevation, how you might screen that and create a transition from the harsh light to the interior, but also acknowledging that people work in, these are the city administration offices, work in here, and sort of allowing the screen to open up to views of the river. One thing that we always feel that if you're going to use this sort of like a screen or a veil over your building, that you still have to understand that north is different to east and south and west, and there are particularities to every site and views you might want to capture, etc. So a one answer elevation over your entire building, I think, is sort of not the right solution. And to the sort of six-lane freeway to the south of the building, we placed the cinemas there, and they're sort of this elevation is sort of like expressing the black box use of the cinema. However, we've always got this inside-outside connection, an understanding of what's happening inside. The administration or the library still had windows, and down here is the gallery shop, and it, you know, should have some sort of frontage and help activate the space. And the urban condition, we felt that it was important that this such a large building shouldn't sort of be a blockage to the space, and we configured the gallery around internal streets, we call them, because in Queensland, and as I mentioned before, thin plan buildings are part of that language and the way we deal with the climate and getting light. So this large building, we made it into sort of a series of thin plan buildings under an all-encompassing roof, so that whenever you're in a large gallery space, once you step out of it, you're back into this more public space that is then connected to the river and to the city and to the bridge and views back to the old existing gallery. And our sketches of how we communicate our ideas to ourselves, which is one thing we say to students, you've got to put your pen on paper as early as you can, because as soon as you want to draw a line, you've got to question yourself what that line is doing. And so we're constantly drawing by hand so we can communicate the problems to ourselves and the ideas to the rest of our team and our consultants and our clients. the final internal perspective drawing before it was built, showing all of the ideas of the loading dock not disturbing the public areas which are through here, and how the internal street re-engages with the river, the public verandas are always connecting indoors to outdoors. Even though a gallery is a very introverted building, we made sure that all the other spaces around those major galleries that have to protect the art, all the other spaces can be more free and connected to the city. And welcoming. So when you're creating public buildings, you're trying to make it so that people feel that those buildings belong to them, and they have no barriers to being able to use the buildings. They become an extension of the public space. Entry foyers and the legibility of stairs for movement, escalators, and how the building might be navigated. And navigation is something that helps with making people feel comfortable. Two ways of doing that is visible connections, understanding where you might go, and the introduction of natural light, which makes you feel comfortable and connected. And natural light has a very big impact on how you behave and how you feel. So the introduction of it into your buildings is always a prime concern. Detailing with acoustic treatments, using local timbers. A section how that might work environmentally. The big roof created a shaded area around the building. It reduces the heat load on the building, and just orientation, screens, timber screens, etc. Even though a gallery needs air conditioning and environmental control, you can still reduce that load by using passive measures, I should say. Large galleries, how they're constructed. These are 15 galleries, including cinemas. And University of Sunshine Coast.
Yeah, I'll just do this, and then Kerry will finish off with the library, so I'll move through pretty quickly. So University of Sunshine Coast Chancery, this was located here where the yellow rectangle is. It sits adjacent to the library by John Mainwaring and Lawrence Neild, which is the centrepiece of the university. So this building had to connect to the existing buildings by Daryl Jackson and, by Vella Neild and Mitchell Jurgler Thorpe, and sit adjacent to this library. Our university recreation club is over here. And in looking at this building, from the car park through to this important library, the sense of the sequence of entry and the relationship of the colonnades sort of meant that there was an important social space that could be made at the junction of these sort of different uses. This was the student services with chancellery over, a series of administration and tutorials, and a large auditorium, 250-seat auditorium, with a student recreation space over. So this was like the nexus or the important space that was the key to understanding how this project could work, by bringing all these separate and diverse uses together and thereby creating the opportunity for another space within the main central plaza. Also, our building, we decided it could be three storeys, which it is to the north, but onto the south we stepped down to the further scale to the important library project. And that's basically the chancellery on the right and the library on the left. And the plan, as I described, the social space, which has a cafe to
activate
the space, a large open student learning deck, which is digitally connected, sitting opposite the chancellery, so that the vice chancellor and all of the sort of hobnobs of the university are sort of on the same level as the students opposite, which we thought was a very sort of democratic decision on behalf of the vice chancellor. and importantly, environmentally, looking at how sunlight would enter, or how we could control sunlight, how we could have each space in the building being naturally ventilated and balanced with natural light, or each space could be separately air conditioned, depending on the users. And that took quite a bit of work to go through with a good environmental consultant to get to work, but in fact that's what we achieved. This is the large sort of social space looking through from the car park onto the main sort of central space of the plan, which is based on the University of Virginia by Thomas Jefferson. And looking back into that space with a cafe and the student learning deck, the chancellery up here on the left and student services on the left also, and the auditorium up on the right, with the auditorium sitting in here. The auditorium, like this space, is raked, but it also has the ability to have brownout, so you can actually have a lecture and still see what's happening on the outside, or be on the outside and see what's happening within. The building was basically reverse masonry veneer, similar to the Cotton Tree Housing Project. That is, all the masses on the inside, and it's clothed in a series of different profiled zinc alum, which Blue Sky loved, I suppose, in terms of... So each of these is a different profile. The vertical strips are windows, the horizontal strips being windows, the vertical strips are generally sort of circulation or recreation areas. So the building is sort of programmatically defined in the elevations, the detail showing that. The large social space with the adjacent cafe. The main circulation spaces are mostly naturally lit and naturally ventilated. This here is where the air conditioning system sits, where it can be turned on for each room separately. So if one room is air conditioned in this place, then the rest of the building is operating naturally. Or alternatively, if it's a stinking hot 37 degree day, they can run the whole building. But generally speaking, the use of air conditioning over the time that the building has been built has gone down every year, as people learn to understand how cross-ventilation works. We made it simple. When they open a window, the vent opens to the other side automatically. So they don't have to actually figure that it might be a good education to teach them that. People don't seem to get it, so we do it for them. So all these spaces are open to circulation, open to light and ventilation, and are not air-conditioned. Stairwells are open. The lecture theatre, as I said earlier, has got displacement air-conditioning. And there's the lecture theatre. The Chancellery itself, while it has a sort of a higher standard of finish, as might befit the Vice Chancellor and the Chancellery, series of meeting rooms which can open onto the space. Instead of having corridors, we have a large veranda-like space in the middle, which sits adjacent the student sort of learning deck. So I think that's important to have that sort of sense of democracy within the university. And the materiality, a very simple building. It came in how much below budget? About $500,000 below budget. And was built on time and was a completely traditional lump sum contract. Kerry, you're talking now about the library. Take a shot.
This is Docklands Library in Melbourne, in the new Docklands area. And I've got 7 minutes, apparently. It's the first time we've ever worked down in Melbourne, so we had to sort of acquaint ourselves with the context, the climate, etc., which is always the important first moves that you might make if you're working in a region that you're not so familiar with. This is our building. This is every other architect's building. And our first concept was it's using a cross-laminated timber product to build it. It's all made out of timber, the structure, including the floor slabs. And our first concept was that we would use this as a double skin. We'd protect the cross-laminated timber with a glass box, which would work as chimneys for the ventilation, etc. And we were moving along well with that idea, but then we were told it was a little bit over budget. Not too much, mind you, but it was enough for us to have to go back and redesign it. But this is Melbourne. This is the city, the traditional city, the HODL grid. And this is Docklands down here, which was the dock area, and it's, you know, big man-made wharf structures. But now it's got sort of Etihad Stadium, and it's got these really large... Look at the size of these footprints compared to the old city. So it really was quite a different grain and not such an inviting one. too much open space, too much distance for people to go to, probably out of balance as far as too much residential. And so the City of Melbourne, the design director here, his project is to try and infill some grain into this area so that it will become more livable like the rest of the city over time. And our site is down here. Lawrence Neild was also working on it, on this area, and he determined that a good public building and a public square there would be the right outcome. So going to that square in a bigger image, here is the library, and the position of it is not only just there for the public interface with this boardwalk and the water, it's also a windbreak for the park behind. So there was sort of a fair environmental driver there of why the building had to be shaped as it is. But because it is a public building and it's a spectacular site, the water and the new park behind, the whole ground floor to us had to be accessible. Because it's a library and it couldn't open up on every face, book security and environmental parameters. So a lot of it is closed facade, but because we made it glazed and very connected, it is all activated facade on the entire ground floor. And that's just showing how, the winter sun angles, the park behind. The canopy was not part of the brief, but we argued that you needed something down there that offered some sort of public gesture. That whole boardwalk is a massive distance and width and walkway, and to create a bit of shelter or a nominal shelter on it was something that would mark it as a public space. It was built on an existing wharf, as I said, and we obtained these drawings, and we had to work around the piers that were there and hopefully not put down any extra new piers. The section shows how we sat on this existing wharf, and our building had to be a light one to sit on the wharf, and that's where the cross-laminated timber idea came from. It's one-third lighter than it conventional building. A early schematic plan showing how we configured the ground plane so that everything was activated to the exterior and to the park, opening out and views opening to the water. And this is the covered area here, upper areas. And the top was, they wanted a roofed terrace. This was an early idea, which in the workings of it became more enclosed because they needed more enclosed space. But we retained this area here with an operable opening roof. The later drawings, the iterations from our double skin ventilating, we were drawing air down and through and back up, and in the end we brought air in down through louvers at the bottom here, some at the top, and chimney effects through the public circulation space, and then out the top, and then other bits of natural light, opening doors, opening roofs. This area is more controlled and air-conditioned. Some of the early sections and construction details that we had to learn about with the cross-laminated timber. That's a core wall slab going in. That's how it sort of starts getting put together. But what we ended up with was a cladding on the outside, which is a rain screen, and that's all recycled hardwoods from Queensland. The decking here is recycled timbers from this wharf area. But you can see inside the building, you can understand that there's activity there, there's this sort of notion of a public space and shelter and publicness. We had to put a circular device on the corner to stop the wind ripping around the corners, so we made it a play space off the children's area. We try and use every opportunity to activate and use the space. As you come into this library, it's a cafe, and it's where you grab a newspaper, many different languages, or you use the interactive tables, and this is one of the first sort of opening. Actually, it's a little bit before it opened, because this is full of magazines and books now. The connection to the outdoors always. Down here is where the louvers open for the natural ventilation on when it's when the weather is right. Showing how we developed that idea and a bit of ventilation up here. Sorry, I'm rushing. We're running out of time here. The stair, which is also the air movement chimney, and clear public wayfinding, which is very important. And transparency from the different levels. Wherever you are in this building, you can actually sort of understand where you have to go, and the connection to the ground floor and the top floor. That's our outdoor room. And details. We feel that people are drawn to or feel more welcome with tactile, and the materials that you use are something that you have to think about to make people comfortable. I'm not sure where it ends here. That's the stair going in. Dropping into place.
So, I think we've run out of time. So we just tried to explain from our perspective how it's important to develop a set of principles and an attitude or a set of ethics that you work with that you can bring to each particular project. And so when you're sitting in your studio and thinking, well, you know, how do I get a concept or what is a concept, you really have to develop a set of principles that you're working to, which looks at the context, understands the building's program, understands environmental consequences, and always sort of strive to a social outcome, which is architecture framing human occupation activity. That's what we've done, and that's what we continue to do. Thanks.